In the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 27, Matthew chapter 27, I shall read verses 55 and 56. Matthew, the 27th chapter, verses 55 and 56. And many women were there beholding afar off, which followed Jesus from Galilee, ministering unto him, among which was Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, and the mother of Zebedee's children. Amen. I want to talk about women of faith. Women of faith. Amen. Thank you, ushers. Women of faith. The greatest influence a woman can have on her family and community is to be a woman of faith. Women of faith have indeed made some of the greatest positive, constructive, and life-changing contributions to our world. Sisters, if you want to be an agent where God can use you to his glory, if you want to have an impact on the next generation, if you want to live so that you will have a long-lasting legacy, it's important that you become a woman of faith. Some of the Lord Jesus' closest followers were women. Women who were faithful to the Lord. And they followed him throughout his earthly ministry. We see at the time of the text that Jesus Christ was being crucified. And scripture informs us that some of the women who had followed the Lord were there looking from a distance. The record says these women were beholding him whilst he hanged there on the cross. The women that he speaks of, he lets us know how honorable they were because of their involvement with Jesus Christ. He specifically names some of the women who were there. He says there was Mary Magdalene, and then Mary, the mother of James and Joseph, who was also known in one of the other gospels as the other Mary. And then there was Salome, who was the mother of James and John, who were the sons of Zebedee. The record speaks of them as being women who are to be honored. And they are honored because of their faith in the Lord. These women that he mentioned are not women who were infamous. They are not known for being evildoers, for being crooked, for being under the influence of Satan, even up to his crucifixion. But rather, they are women who have been recorded in the Holy Writ to show us that they were women of faith. And oh, my brothers and sisters, God spotlights them because of their faith in him. And you know, God don't see things the way the world does. The world spotlights people for different other reasons. The world spotlights women because of their pretty faces. Many times they show them, put them on the front of a magazine because of their attractive face. others are spotlighted because of their fitness if she's shaped just right. They will spotlight her. Others are spotlighted because of their finances. If they're wealthy, got a lot of money, the world will spotlight them. Are y'all praying with me? Others are spotlighted because of being famous. Be they movie stars or married to somebody who is holding a high office. Somebody who has come from a famous family. Maybe some movie star, actor. Many are making the headlines and they are spotlighted because they are famous. Others are spotlighted because of their function in society. If they're CEOs of a company, have their own business, and have become very successful. The world will spotlight them. But then the world will also spotlight women for being foolish. Women who get involved in things that's scandalous, things that's seductive and sexual lifestyle. Women who are known to be killers. The world will spotlight them. But God spotlights women of faith. Mind you now, women of faith have not always been women of faith. And not just women, but all of us. All of us who are saved have a past. You'd be surprised what some of us used to do. Are y'all with me here? So God takes note of people who have faith in him. As a matter of fact, Hebrews 11:6 says, but without faith, it's impossible to please God. You can't make it into heaven based on how you dress. It doesn't matter how much money you have, how much land you own, how attractive you are. If you want to please God, you got to have faith. And so these women in the text are spotlighted because of their faith. Well, the question comes, what kind of faith did they possess? What kind of faith did they have? Why was Matthew, Mark, and Luke led to tell us about these women who were present at the crucifixion of Jesus our Lord, looking from a distance? What kind of faith did they have? Well, first of all, they had saving faith. It's a faith that'll get you saved. Are you listening to me? Saving faith is a faith that will change your life. It is to trust Christ as your Savior. It's the kind of faith that says, Lord, I'm a sinner. Yes. And I know that I'm on my way to hell. Yes. But I believe that you gave your son. Yes. And I believe that he is the Redeemer. Yes. And I ask you to come into my life and save me. That's saving faith. It's a faith that believes that God can save you from eternal damnation. Yes, he says, he said they have faith because their faith is a saving faith. Now listen, if you don't have saving faith, there's no other kind of faith you're going to be able to have. You got to, it all starts with saving faith. You got to become a child of God. See, faith in God to save you means that God will change you. Man can't change you. A woman can't change you. You need the grace of God. And these women, they had a sinful past, but they had faith in the Lord, and they became changed. Let me show you. If you look at the first one who's mentioned, her name is Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was demon-possessed. As a matter of fact, the Bible says she had seven devils. Now listen, let me tell you something. If you got one devil, you can be a whole lot of trouble. But this woman had seven devils. But her faith in Christ changed her life. Now, if the Lord can change somebody who has seven devils, don't you know he can change your life and mine? He's able to change your life and give you a new outlook, new desires, new attitude. He's able to change you. And it's called being born again. And the Bible says, whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. These women have saving faith. Oh, my brothers and sisters, we need to learn from them that if you're going to please God, you got to be sure that you have saving faith. Saving faith is the kind of faith you have regardless of how you've been, regardless of how you lived. God is able and willing to save you. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul said, and you hath he quickened who were dead in trespasses and in sin. Yeah, he said, but by grace are you saved through faith. See, the grace of God cares nothing about how you live, because God is able to make you new in Christ Jesus. It's called saving faith. These women are there because they have saving faith. But not only that, but they also had simple faith. Simple faith. What do you mean when you say simple faith? It's a faith that will simply take God at his word. I mean, it is to take God at his word. Whatever God say, you don't question it, you don't doubt it, but you take him at his word. This is the kind of faith that Mary, the mother of Jesus, had. The angel Gabriel came to her and told her, you are blessed and highly favored among women. And say that God has selected you to give birth to the Savior of the world. And all Mary said was, be it unto me according to your word. She submitted. She didn't try to question God. She didn't ask a question in doubt and unbelief, but she simply took God at his word. And if you want to please God, you got to take him at his word. In John chapter 4, there was a certain nobleman who came to Jesus on behalf of his son. He said, Lord, would you come to my house and see about my son? Jesus said, well, unless you see signs and wonders, you won't believe. All right. The man said, sir, please, if you don't come save my son, He gonna die.
All right.
Jesus said, go wherever you're going, your son gonna live.
Okay.
And the Bible said the man left, and the next day, when the man was on his way home, his servants met him and said, your son is fine. The man said, when did he start getting well? Yesterday. The man didn't go home until the next day. And the question comes, why didn't he go home the same day? Because he took Jesus at his word. See, if you don't take him at his word, you go home the same day to check and see if what Jesus said is the truth. But this man had faith in what the Lord said. He took him at his word. It's simple faith. You know, faith is not as complicated as some folk try to make it. My members know many times the example I always use is how simple faith is. You got to do God's word just like y'all did that pew that you're sitting on. I have no doubt every last one of you, when you came in here, you didn't shake it and test it to see if it would hold. You just sat because you had faith. Now, if you can trust a pew to hold you, why can't you trust God and take him at his word? Simple faith. But then thirdly, they had strong faith. They had strong faith. I know they did, because look, Jesus has been taken and nailed to a cross. He's there hanging on the cross, and they showed up. The other disciples were somewhere high. But these women were there. They had faith enough to have courage, boldness to show up at his crucifixion. Are y'all listening to me? They had some strong faith. It was a faith that wouldn't allow them to be afraid to be identified as followers of Jesus Christ. No. They had strong faith. Their faith was unstoppable. Their faith was unshakable and unmovable. They kept their faith even through this difficult time. You see, when you got strong faith, no matter how tough the times may get in your life, you still gonna hold on to your faith in God. Yes, you keep your faith, and sometimes it will get difficult. Sometimes it will get mighty inconvenient, but you ought to hold on to your faith in God. And you know, sometimes you got to do like the woman who had this, your blood, but you got to learn how to talk to yourself. In Mark chapter 5, the woman, she had heard about Jesus, and she had spent all the money, and she said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment. And Matthew says she said within herself, she encouraged herself. Sometimes you can't wait around for other folk to encourage you. You got to motivate and encourage yourself. You got to encourage yourself. Man and his little boy, his son, went to a supermarket. Had son in the shopping cart, and little boy just screaming and hollering. He's pushed him through. Supermarket man said, just hang on, Albert, just hang on. Hang on. And little boy kept screaming and hollering. Man kept going down the aisle of the supermarket. He said, just a little bit longer, Albert, just a little bit longer. Almost there. So finally, when he got to checkout stand, got ready to check out, cashier said, sir, I want to commend you on the way you encouraged little Albert. He kept screaming and crying, but you just kept encouraging little Albert, and I feel like you should be commended. The man looked at the cashier and said, ma'am, My name is Albert. His name is Mickey. Sometimes you gotta encourage yourself. Can't always wait for other folk to give you encouragement. Quit waiting on a phone call for somebody to call you and check on you. You got to encourage yourself. If nobody call you and tell you you're going to make it, you got to tell yourself, in the name of the Lord, I'm going to make it. So look at them. Here they are. Right there at this difficult time, Jesus is being crucified, but they're still there. You see, a test of your faith is when you can stay with the Lord, even when it looks like things not gonna work out. You can't have a faith that changes like the weather. You know, you're on today and off tomorrow. You can't have a water faucet faith. You got to have strong faith. You got to have the kind of faith that Abraham had.
Yes, yes.
God told him that you and Sarah are going to have a baby.
Yes.
Abraham was 100. Yes. Sarah 90. He said, what? Sarah said, what? Have you looked at yourself? But the Bible said that he was strong in faith.
Yes, sir.
And Sarah got pregnant.
Yes.
And they had a bouncing baby boy that they named Isaac. When you're strong in faith, regardless of how things look, God got ways of bringing it to pass. Now. Don't go out here trying to act like Abraham and Sarah. But I mean in other areas, you need to be strong in faith. Then finally, not only did they have saving faith, simple faith, strong faith, but they had faith that could be seen. Notice what the text said. They followed him from Galilee to Jerusalem, ministering unto him. They had a faith that could be seen. They were seen serving him. Listen, real faith in the Lord is done by a person who is serving him. James put it this way, faith without works is dead. There ought to be some evidence of your faith.
Yes, sir.
Yes, they proved they had faith in him by ministering unto him.
All
right. Look, they served him before he was arrested.
Right.
They served him before he was betrayed.
Yes.
They served him before he was hung up on the cross. They did this before it happened. But even when it happened, they were still serving. Oh, brothers and sisters, that's the kind of faith God wants us to have. Y'all serving no matter what the times may be. Whether things are going well or they've gone bad, you got to keep on serving the Lord. Oh, my brothers and my sisters, their faith was visible.
Yes, sir.
Yes, in Mark chapter 2, there was a man that was being brought to Jesus who was paralyzed.
Okay.
And the record said they couldn't get the man to Jesus because the crowd was standing in the way.
All right.
And so they decided to go up on top of the house. And they opened up a spot in the roof and let the man down into the presence of Jesus.
All right.
And Mark says,
And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the man who was sick of the palsy, son, your sins are forgiven. Mark said the Lord saw their faith. If you have faith, somebody ought to be able to see it. Yes, your ways and actions reveal whether or not we have faith in God. So as I close, my brothers and sisters, God is looking for some folk who are willing to have faith. Faith can get you through anything. Faith, my brothers and sisters, will keep you when the storm of life is raging. Faith in God will open doors that folk thought could never be opened. Faith in God can move mountains in your life. Am I right about it? Faith in God can bring healing where doctors have said, I can't do you any good. Yes, there's nothing like faith in God. The Bible says with men it is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And so these women, my brothers and sisters, are women who held on to their faith in the Lord. And I'm glad they maintained faith in the Lord. Because this same Jesus that they saw hanging on the cross, a few days later, they saw him alive again. Am I right about it? Yes, when you got faith in God, you might be a victim on Friday, but he'll make you a victor on Sunday. Am I right about it? When you got faith in God, God is able to get you through anything. Don't care how rough it gets in your life. He said, hold on to your faith in God. Paul said, we are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We are persecuted, but never forsaken. We are not down, but we are not knocked out. Because when you have faith in God, God is able to keep you going. Am I right about that? He's able to maintain you. He's able to preserve you. Have I got a witness? Well, my brothers and sisters, as I leave you here today, I come to tell somebody it's time to have faith in the Lord. Whatever you are facing right now, I come to tell you, have faith in God. Jesus said, if you have faith in God, you can speak to your mountain and tell your mountain to move out of the way. And that mountain got to move, because faith in God will get things done. Am I right about it? Well, there was a story told about a man who was looking for a job. He went down on his knees in prayer and talked to the Lord about it. And the Lord showed him a company that was located downtown. On Monday, he went down there to that job. And he put in an application. And they told him, yes, we're not hiring. He went on back to the house, got down on his knees, talked to God about it. On Tuesday, he went back to that same job. And when he went back, they told him, we can't hire you because you don't have enough education. He went back to the house, went down on his knees, talked to God again. When Wednesday came, he went back to that same job and he told him, I'm still looking for a job. They said, well, sir, you don't have enough experience. He went on back to the house, got down on his knees, prayed to the Lord. When Thursday came, he went back to the job. He said, said, I'm still looking for a job. They said, well, I told you, yes, you don't have enough education. You don't have enough experience. And we ain't hiring. If you come back here again, we're going to call the police on you. He went on back to the house, got down on his knees, and prayed to the Lord. When Friday came, he went right back to that same old job. He told them, I'm still looking for a job. They said, wait a minute. We told you not to come back. We're going to call the police. And they made such a disturbance talking to the man that the CEO came out and he said, what's going on? The human resources person said, well, sir, I told this man, starting on Monday, we're not taking no application. He don't have enough experience. He don't have no education. And I told the man, if he come back again, I'm gonna call the police. And here he showed back up. And the man said, wait a minute, let me talk to him. Said, sir, why did you keep coming back? The man said, well, I got down on my knees and I told the Lord, and I got faith that God's gonna give me a job. He said, wait a minute, young man. You mean you asked the Lord to give you a job here, and you got faith that he gonna give it to you? He said, yes. He said, well, young man, let me tell you something. Over 20 years ago, the same thing happened to me right here. The Lord to give me a job. They kept turning me away, but God stepped in, and now I'm the CEO of this company. He looked at the human resource person and said, y'all hide, because it just may be he's gonna be the next CEO. Ain't God alright? Stay with God. Have faith in him. He will make a way. Won't he do it? I know he will. Hold on. Keep your hand in God's hand. Stay with Jesus all the way. Serving the Lord will pay off.